Okay, hello everybody. Welcome to the first discrete optimization talks of 2021. We're very pleased to have Mervyn Ward today to speak about some recent results of theirs in inverse optimization, inverse mixed integer optimization, and stochastic programming. And so our first speaker for the day is my colleague, Mervyn Boudour. No nepotism here, as she just happens to do very interesting work and so well-deserved speaker in that way. Mervyn is an assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering at the University of Toronto. She did her PhD at Wisconsin-Madison and a postdoc at Georgia Tech. And her research interests span integer programming, multi-objective optimization, and applications in energy systems, transportations, et cetera. And so today she'll be speaking to us about inverse mixed integer optimization. So Mervyn, please take it away.
Thank you very much, Elias. Hello, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank Alex and Elias for organizing this like amazing seminar series. Also, thank you so very much for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to be here today for such a wonderful audience to present my work. Hashtag Knights of MIP, I would say. So today I will talk about inverse optimization. So I thought like as everything in the world is turned upside down this year, like why not to flip our optimization, favorite optimization problems, right? So more specifically, I will present a work, joint work with Professor Tim Chen from University of Toronto and our joint PhD student Ian Zhu. And I will say Ian deserves most of the credit of the work. Thus, if you have any, all of the tough questions, he deserves them as well. So in this work, I will provide some polynomial insights for inverse mixed integer programs. And based on those observations, we will propose a truss region-based cutting plane algorithm. So what is inverse optimization? So I will call it in short IO to save some time. So in IO, we will flip our traditional optimization setup. So this time the solution to the problem is known. And we have, for instance, an observed decision from the past. What is unknown though is some problem parameters. And the goal in inverse optimization is to infer those parameters which render this given solution optimal or if you like near optimal. So here's a pretty cool picture I took from Robert Bosch's website. It's an imitation of the hands portion of Michelangelo's famous painting. And this week actually, to be honest, I seen the Bernie Sanders mittens version of this, which indeed I believe has potential to become a bit more famous. But in this one, if you think about it, actually Robert obtained this picture as a near optimal solution to a 12,000 city TSP instance. And if you think about it, which is also pointed by the blog post by John Cook, if you think about it, Robert is indeed here doing a sort of an inverse optimization for some of his artwork. So he's searching for an optimization problem to yield a desired solution as an optimal or near optimal. Inverse optimization has found a wide range of applications. For instance, in a portfolio optimization problem, having an observed portfolio at hand, we might be interested in inferring someone's perception of item values or their risk preferences. In routing problems, we can use travel paths to infer some network attributes or driver preferences. The next two I will discuss in a bit more detail shortly, but at this point, what I would like to highlight is that actually, most of the time, the primary goal is not just to learn these unobserved parameters, but rather use these inferences in turn in decision-making, such as to build new portfolios for investors or design networks to recommend routes to drivers, so on and so forth. In the same spirit, IO has found frequently appeared in bi-level problems, I would say, for instance, the ones aiming at designing tolls, taxes, and so on. Early research in IO was driven by actually geophysical scientists who wanted to estimate model parameters such as like transmission times of these seismic waves using some observed earthquake data as early as 80s actually. And this actually very problem is an example of an inverse shortest path problem which is introduced by Burton and Toit around 90s. And since then, IO has received an increasing amount of attention in our own optimization community. And in that regard, let me provide details about these other two applications that I skipped in the previous slide. So the first one is on energy markets. Consider an electricity pool where we have a bunch of producers in the system. Actually, it was the very last dot talk on December where my PhD student Chang actually talked about this. In practice, such markets are usually cleared using an optimization problem, most commonly a linear program. And in such a setting, imagine that we have this strategic producer who might be highly interested in the knowledge of his rivals offering prices in order to be able to determine his own strategy to achieve his maximum possible profit, for instance. However, I would say this key piece of information, his rivals offering prices, it is generally not available to him. What is known though is this figure on the right that you can see, this tiny figure on the right. So namely, what we might be knowing, aware of, is this market hourly outcome such as production amounts, as well as some consumer demand, but also the market clearing prices. Basically, this LP's optimal solution, it becomes known to this strategic player. In other words, this tiny plot on the right, it becomes known to this market agents a little bit after market clearance happens. So in that regard, you can use inverse optimization to infer your rivals' offering prices. The second application I would like to detail a bit more is by our own collaborator Tim Chen on radiation therapy. In treatment planning problems, there are usually multiple conflicting objectives that we need to balance. And the very standard approach is to combine them into a single objective. And in practice, these objective ways in the combination are typically decided by clinicians via, I will say, trial and error. And in this very domain, inverse optimization can help us quantifying the implicit preferences of clinicians, and we can then use them, these inferred parameters, to create, for instance, new treatment plans for new patients in the future. So there are very different, like, general IO setups, I would say, but we will be focusing on the most traditional one. And in this one, we are given an optimization problem, which is now called in this domain a forward optimization problem. And we will refer to it as a set of feasible solutions as the forward feasible set. And we will be considering only linear objectives. There could very well be, of course, multiple optimal solutions to an optimization problem. They are now called forward optimal points, and their set we will be denoting by this calligraphic F. In the most traditional IO setting, we are trying to infer objective coefficient vector C. I would say, like, although there are a few studies on the literature that is focusing on estimating constraint parameters, actually the vast majority of papers out there, they are focusing on estimating the cost vector, which is what we will do as well. So what are our inputs? So our first input is this given a priori guess of the objective function C naught, and then we are given a candidate solution that we are trying to render as an optimal one. And of course, some information, basically the feasible set of our forward problem, our MIP. And the goal in IO, but at this point, this is the general IO setup. It doesn't even have to be MIP. But the goal in IO is basically to find an objective vector C that is minimizing the distance from the reference point C naught. And here you can use any norm. I'm just giving a one norm as an example. And this candidate vector C should make our given solution X hat a forward optimal one. So we will denote the feasible set of the inverse problem by this calligraphic C, which will be a central object that we will analyze in the upcoming part. So this is called the inverse feasible set, which is basically the set containing all the C vectors making this given X hat solution a forward optimal one. Here's a quick example. Basically, I think I missed the example. So here's a quick example that basically here the feasible forward feasible region is this blue box X, and this X star X hat is given as this candidate corner point extreme point. And in this example, our inverse feasible set will be this cone basically. So if any C vector, and actually I am here plotting the negative of the C vector because we are minimizing the actual negative of the objective vector is denoting the optimization direction. So basically any C vector or negative of it from this pink cone, it is going to be inverse feasible. And the one that we desire to find is the one that is as close as possible to this reference point C naught. In the most traditional IO setting, we are trying to again infer this objective function. And here again, I have pink IO and the forward problem there. If we look at the literature, we see that the majority of the research is dedicated to the case where this blue forward problem is indeed convex. And despite the fact that we have a lot of developments in discrete optimization and discrete decisions appear in many real life applications, there have been unfortunately only very few advances in inverse MIP. If you look at the convex case, the standard approach is basically to reformulate the problem as a single level convex problem via KKT conditions. And maybe this might explain part of the challenge in addressing inverse MIPs, because the fact that, like, the optimality conditions for MIP generally do not lead to very computation tractable algorithms like they do have in the convex case. In that regard, Andrew Schaeffer used this super-additive duality to reformulate inverse pure integer programs and later extended it, this idea with Lamparsky to the case of mixed integer inverse MIPs. And using sub-additive, basically super-additive duality, what they done is In their works, they provided a polyhedral description of the inverse feasible set, but the downside is the resulting single level formulation is actually an exponentially large linear program. Therefore, they can only address instances with, I would say, like only a very few number of decision variables. The only other main idea from the literature for general inverse MIPS is a cutting plane algorithm developed by Wang in 2009. And it is also revisited by Bulut and Ralphs in 2015, but they were mostly focusing on complexity analysis. I will explain the details of this cutting plane algorithm in very much detail shortly, but what I would like to mention is since it is built on this idea of iteratively generating extreme points while solving this forward problem, which is a MIP, it can be computationally very costly, as you can imagine. As such, this algorithm can only solve very small size problems efficiently. The only advance to this method since its development is this heuristic parallelizing the search of these extreme points. So all in all, I would say that even after a decade, Wang's algorithm remains the state of the art in solving inverse MIPS. And our work is actually building on this cutting plane algorithm. So next I will explain the cutting plane algorithm in detail, then present some of our these polyhedral insights on the inverse problem, which motivated us to actually enhance this algorithm. All right, so let's start with our inverse MIP setting. Again, on the pink, I have the IO problem and the forward problem, which is a pure MIP now. So as in the convex case, let's try to characterize basically this critical object, the inverse feasible region. So what we can do is we can reformulate the optimality conditions via this infinite set of linear constraints. So what they are saying basically is for any forward feasible point X, this given X hat solution should provide either the same or a better, smaller objective value. And as observed by Wang, it is straightforward to see that this set can be replaced by a finite, but of course, potentially exponential number of constraints, only considering the extreme points of the convex solve. Basically, I am denoting with this calligraphic E of X, the extreme point set of the convex Hallof are mixed integer feasible set X. So basically you can replace this infinitely many constraints with a finitely many using only the extreme points. So then here's the basic cutting plane algorithm. Basically that will generate those extreme points on the fly. And at every iteration, the master problem will consider only a subset of the extreme points, this capital XI, and it will make you suggestions for the new candidate vector CI, for which we will solve the forward problem to obtain a forward optimal solution XI, and we will check this cut, right? So if this cut is violated by this candidate forward problem solution, we will add it to our master problem and continue. And of course, as there are finitely many extreme points overall, and we are discovering a new one at every iteration, this algorithm will converge in finitely many iterations. So here's a quick pictorial representation of the full run of the cutting plane algorithm on a simple example. Suppose the forward feasible set is the set of integer points in this gray region. Basically, this shaded gray region is the convex hull. So the cutting plane algorithm will first propose us the original CNOT solution, because we start with no cuts whatsoever, and we are trying to find the closest C vector to the CNOT. So we will start with the CNOT as the master problem's first suggestion. And if you take the CNOT, push it as much as you can to optimize, you will basically stop something like at this level, and you will discover this extreme point XNOT. And since we see that in terms of this candidate objective CNOT, this X0 is doing better than our target X hat, we should cut this off. So we are going to introduce a cut, which will only allow master problem in the next iterations to choose any candidate C for which our X hat will be performing either the same or better, right? So in that regard, master problem's next candidate solution will be this red C1 vector, which is the closest one to the reference point for which X0 and X hat, they are actually yielding the very same objective value. So then using this C1, we will optimize and we will obtain this X1 as our next candidate extreme point, for which we will add the second cut that will lead to the C2 as the next master problem guess. If we repeat, we go to the next extreme point, discover X2, and then C3 will be the last candidate, because if you now have to optimize C3, you will be able to see that you find no more violated cuts, so you stop. So in practice, we observe that this cut generation procedure can take a long time because we are solving one MIP as a subproblem after all. Plus, that is even worse that we might need to get a large number of cuts to convert. So our main question was, can we do any better? So our goal is actually to improve the time to compute cuts as well as reduce the number of cuts that we need. and hopefully achieve these two at the very same time. In that regard, we introduced this concept of generator sets, which yields a new characterization of optimality conditions for general inverse mirrors. And we provide some necessary and sufficient conditions for generator sets, as well as we show that there could very well exist this small generator sets, which are very attractive from a computational perspective. And motivated by all these insights, we propose a new variant of the Banks cutting plane algorithm where we incorporate trust regions. So we also have further computational enhancements that I will shortly talk about. And our algorithm, we also can easily extend it to the case where you have multiple input data points rather than a single X hat. And finally, through extensive computational results, we demonstrate that our new cutting plane algorithm is significantly outperforming the state of the art by solving the largest and most difficult instances in the literature to date. Next, I will introduce our observations on the inverse MIP problems. Again, here in pink, I have the IO problem, and in green, I have alternative optimality conditions to start with. Our key observation is that the extreme points, they are sufficient, but not necessary to characterize inverse optimality. For instance, if you take any forward feasible point X, it can be seen as a generator because it's generating like this type of a cut, right? That's why we are calling it generator similar in the IP literature. So then formally, we call a given set of vectors G, this guy, a generator set if this type of cuts generated by the points in it, they are sufficient to describe our inverse feasible region. And as you can see easily, the examples of generator set includes the forward feasible set itself, the set of its extreme points of the convex hull. But the key I would like to point out the fact that this G doesn't have to be a subset of our forward feasible set. So it might very well include some interior points from the convex hull or even exterior points about our problem. So here's a quick example where the forward feasible set X, again, it is consisting of the integer points in this gray shaded area. And on the right here now, we have the inverse feasible region, this pink cone. And these pink lines that you see, these half spaces, they are the ones generated, the cuts generated by the extreme points of the convex hull of our forward feasible region. So now I would like to talk about two observations. The first one is that if you look at the problem, these pink half spaces, they are formed by the extreme points. They could very well be generated by using these blue interior points. Basically, the set of extreme points, this observation tells us that they are not necessary to characterize inverse feasibility, and instead they can be replaced with a set of interior, even exterior points. So the next set of observation that I would like to make is that by using actually far fewer points than the number of extreme points, in this example, it is 7, we can actually have a generator set. For instance, in this case, actually, had we had only X1, which is the only integer point actually on this ray, plus any integer point on the second net, for instance, this blue point, this would have constituted a generator set. So that would have been enough for us to prove optimality, inverse optimality. So here's actually a characterization of forward feasible generator sets. Let me explain it maybe again over the example. So what we would like is, for instance, let's take this again, this X1, and this maybe blue point, interior point, integer point. And basically we are looking at this convex hull where we take these two points as the generator set. So this is gonna be a generator set if and only if you take these two points and also add our given X set solution and look at their convex hull, this blue shaded region. So if this is a generator set, if and only if it includes this red shaded space, which is obtained by any epsilon ball centered at X hat, and intersected with our gray convex hull region. So if this is true, if you can basically build a set whose convex hull will cover this piece of an epsilon ball, this is a characterization of a generator set. So basically this example illustrates that actually we must need X1 in any generator set because there's no other forward feasible integer point on that ray from X hat to X1. So putting these things together, I would say that our key takeaways for a forward feasible generator set is we can actually do the job with many fewer points than the number of extreme points. Plus, we can actually generate very stronger cuts from by some interior points. And the points, I would say, that are even much closer to our X hat. So that is special. So actually, this gives us this key idea of generating cuts by identifying interior points, even the ones closer to our X hat, using trust regions. And again, guided by our characterization, we define our trust regions to be characterized around this target point x hat. And here you can use any norm and any diameter, and we play with those, of course, in the algorithm. So then if you basically take your forward feasible set and intersect it with this trust region, the obtained resulted, like resulting restricted forward feasible set, it is actually more likely to have, to be honest, like a smaller number of extreme points, and it can in turn reduce the number of points that we need to discover to prove optimality to build a generator set. Plus, again, because this set has fewer number of extreme points, it might be easier to solve those MIPS, restricted MIPS, rather than the original MIPS. So hopefully we can achieve these two actually at the same time. So this is our, again, here's a quick example to illustrate trust regions. Here's again our initial picture for the pure cutting plane algorithm, where again, remember, we would have identified x0 using the first candidate solution from the master c0, and it would have led to the c1 as the next candidate. So now, had we instead restricted our search to this blue square obtained by this trust region using the infinity norm and radius of one, for instance, then we would have obtained these two extreme points in this restricted region. We would have had two options, and by optimizing C0, we would have discovered this X0 as the next interior point, which is closer to X hat, and actually it's providing us a stronger cut than our red one on the left. So next, if had we used the trust region with a doubled size, actually, again, using the infinite norm, we would have this time identified directly in the first shot this x0, and then getting this candidate in the next iteration, we would all converge right away. So this example also illustrating the potential benefits of incorporating trust regions. Here's another quick example. This time I'm using one norm, therefore we do have this rotated square as a trust region. And in this example, again, if you look at the restricted feasible region, the integer points in it, you have these two options, one of which being an interior point. And actually these two blue points, they do have this, a stronger cut generation potential than all these six extreme points that you could have generated. And plus, if again, you look at this trust region here, basically you will see that it has only two extreme points versus our original forward feasible region had many other extreme points. So this is a great example to illustrate that we maybe have the potential to get stronger cuts, but also faster. So basically here's the trust region enhanced version of our algorithm. As usual, we start with no cuts. At every iteration, get a candidate solution. But this time we are looking at the trust region restricted version. And if you find the cut from this restricted version, edit. Otherwise, we basically update the trust region to look for some more. So here are a couple of enhancements ideas that I will go very quickly that we incorporated into our final design. First of all, we periodically remove trust regions to avoid being overly conservative at all times. And combined with the trust regions, this creates actually a very, very effective cut generation subroutine. Second one is like this, in order to like improve cut generation speed, we have this early stopping heuristic for the forward problem, because like we know that the optimal solution to the forward problem, it may not be the best anyways. Plus, we may have already discovered it, but just spend a lot of time to prove optimality. So in that regard, early stop would be very helpful. The last one is this idea of reducing the dimension of our trust regions with the observation that if actually we look at the points that we need, they're actually looking very much similar to this X hat. They do have many common components with X hat. You don't need this large dimension. That's why we basically in the algorithm randomly build a set of indices and accordingly fix this indices, some of the indices in our search region to be the same as the ones in our target X hat. So in the last minute or so, I would like to show you the overview of our computational results. You can find many more in the paper. So our test instances are based on MIPLIP instances, and by randomizing them, we have over 200 inverse MIP instances, and we are comparing five algorithms. The first one, CP here, is the pure Wang's cutting plane algorithm. Then it is combined version with this early stop heuristic to improve cut generation speed. The next one is this TR version that we are incorporating, just the TR combined with early stop, and TR early stop combined with the dimensionality reduction, everything together. So here we are looking at performance profiles of all these considered five algorithms. So you want to be close to this top left corner, right? So what we observe here is that I would say, if we look at these two options, which are the TR versions of our algorithms, they're actually solving many more instances, but also faster. For instance, it's striking to see that if we look at the CP, the original cutting plane algorithm, solving 66 instances in about an hour, for which we are spending only 2.5% of the time. So in 90 seconds, we can kill them all. So we are solving more and also faster thanks to achieving both of our goals as mentioned. And here's just last slide, just one single instance that I want to show you to give exactly what's happening inside. And this is a very common case, I will say. So it's a representative instance. For instance, here we are looking at the number of cutting plane iterations and the total time spent by that iteration. So if we start by looking at the pure cutting plane algorithm, you will see that here you got stuck. After solving the first MIP or two, you got stuck. On the other hand, early stop, it saves you something a little bit, but if you incorporate trust regions, then you can achieve both goals and converge faster by discovering stronger cuts in a faster manner. So I guess overall, I would say that we have a very simple but very, very effective idea to improve inverse MIP solution methodology cutting plane algorithm. And more details you can find in our preprint available online. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Mehve. I think you win the award for finishing your talk on time as a first speaker in DOTS. So great. So we have time for a couple live questions. Maybe are there any? Please feel free to unmute and ask or type them in the chat. There were a few questions that were already answered, I think, during the talk.
Oh, great. I wasn't looking at the chat screen.
Yeah, by Ian or by your
subsequent. Yeah, all the hard questions. Ian is here.
Explanations, yeah.
So yeah, but I will be around also after the talk. If you can stick around, we can also maybe discuss after the talk if we are out of time.
We will have the usual breakout rooms.
Yeah, so maybe I'll ask a high-level question, Mehve, about the connection between inverse optimization and the smart predict and optimize setting. So there, let's say you have the same, you have the forward feasible region is the same, and only say only the objective varies as a function of some features. Is there a generalization of the inverse optimization MIP setting to somehow that setting?
So actually, that's a great question. And in fact, like I've been very much interested in looking into smart predict and optimize these days. So I'm still going through the paper in detail. But I would say like in IO right now, we are not actually doing the same thing as they are doing and taking the downstream decisions into account, right? Right now, our key, especially in this work, our key has been, just like in the literature, kind of characterizing the all inverse feasible solutions and accordingly picking the one closest to your target without worrying about the impact of what you are going to do with it next, right? So these guys kind of opened up the door, and actually Ian is currently thinking about potential downstream decisions and hoping to incorporate it into the IO setting, I would say. But at the moment, we are still doing as in machine learning, just the predictions, inferences, without worrying about how these inferences in turn will be used.
I see. Yeah, that makes sense. Thank you.
Welcome.
So there's a question in the chat from Sven. How much harder is your problem if the inverse parameters are the constraints? So parts of the A matrix or the B right-hand side vector.
So first of all, like since we only have this one target of the objective and we have the norm there, and if you are, for instance, using one norm, you can easily linearize it. So our master problem can also stay as simple as possible, a linear program. But if you have also some predictions in the constraints, it will change the feasible region, right? So our MIP feasible region will be now parameterized by those. So the cuts that you are getting, just like the banders, right? If you just have the objective uncertainty, you go to the dual, the cuts are only parameterized there, your dual feasible region is fixed. So you can get this globally valid cut easily. But I believe, I haven't thought about it very thoroughly, but my first impression is if you're also forward feasible region is parameterized by the master decisions, you need something like logic-based cuts to also incorporate it, because they are not going to be necessarily valid for any master candidate, right? So I would definitely guess that it will be more involved. But I haven't, to be honest, thought about it in detail yet. So we can maybe chat more afterwards.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Mehve. And please stay around for discussions after Ward's talk if you're interested in talking to the speaker.